Welcome. So right now I'm going to be discussing this article. It's a 1995 article, and I'm looking up my notes just because, of course, I don't know the article by heart and all the different points I wanted to go over. So the article, it's a 1995 article. Somebody recommended it to me from TikTok because I had posted a video talking about South American origins in Central West Mexico, and I was talking mostly about Jalisco and Michoacan, and I was mostly only talking about what I knew about I guess these archaeological studies that talk about the trade between South America and Michoacan, Jalisco, and Nayarit. But I wasn't aware of any, you know, any articles that actually suggested, right, that folks from the Mexican Central West, that they came from South America. And so this article was recommended for me to check it out. And it's by Vincent H. Malmstrom. Sorry if I said that wrong. And the title of it is Geographical Origins of the Tarascans. It's in the Geographical Review, volume 85, number 1. And it was written in 1995. And so let's hop to it. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about, I'm not going to go over the whole article, you know, so for those of you who are students and probably got assigned this, you know, I'm sorry to break it to you, but I'm not going to go over everything. I'm just going to talk more about, I guess, kind of my thoughts on the article after reading. And again, this is in 1995, and actually I haven't had a chance to read anything new that he's written since then, so... I apologize if I'm talking about anything that might be outdated that maybe he might have already kind of updated since the last time he touched on this subject. But again, I'm just kind of more the point of this video was more just to kind of have that discussion about this article because you know, I actually found it interesting as well. Okay, so I just wanted to talk about first the abstract. I'm gonna talk about some of the, I guess, interesting points, right, that stuck out to me from the article, and kind of some points, right, that I had, like, I don't know, that I just kind of found, like, I guess, kind of, I don't know, I guess that I kind of had questions about, right, or that I was not too sure about, or that I kind of, I don't want to say disagree, but more like that I guess it kind of caused me to question it in other sorts of ways. So anyways, let's start off with the abstract for those of you who haven't had a chance to read this yet. And I'll also include a link below if you want to see where you can identify, find the article, right? So the abstract is, after the destruction of the Aztec Empire, the Spanish learned that the Tarascans or Purépecha of Michoacán were culturally different from their neighbors. The origin of the Purépecha continues to intrigue. Clues include linguistic affinity and long-established trade links with the Andean region and overseas contact to the south. The evidence indicates a South American background for the Purépecha. Okay, so I guess just kind of my overall thoughts. So of course, so again, in this article, you know, the anthropologist Vincent Malmstrom, he contemplated, you know, whether or not the indigenous peoples of Michoacán came from South America. So just overall, of course, you know, to save you from you know, wondering what's the outcome, right, of the article, so he's not able to, I guess, prove that this was the case, right, that they came from South America, right? But what his work does do is that it hammers in the point that there was definitely contact and influence between the Purépecha or the indigenous peoples of Michoacán and the native peoples of South America. So he begins by, he talks about this origin myth, the origin myths, right, of South American origins that that various Spaniards recorded in Michoacán, and I wasn't clear if this example that he was citing, I don't know if it was from Vasco de Quiroga or if this was some other group of Spaniards who had interviewed the natives. I'm assuming he was talking about Vasco de Quiroga, and I will say though that the writings of Tata Vasco, I'm not familiar with myself. I have yet to read them all. I know he has some published primary sources that are accessible now, but that's one department where I need to kind of read up more on is on his actual writings. But anyways, one of the myths, these origin myths that he cites, right, I think it comes from Vasco de Quiroga, and it has to do with the Purépecha natives who told them about a migration myth where they came to Michoacán from Cusco riding on the backs of turtles, right? And of course, right, one way to kind of interpret this, right, because of course, you know, one of the things that he points out that, yes, you know, it sounds ridiculous, right, like riding on the backs of turtles, but again, this is mythology, right, and it could also be, you know, today we might even say, like, hey, well, maybe, you know, the turtle might be a reference to a boat, right, the boats that they might have used, you know, to cross from the Andes, if they came from the Andes, right, to Michoacán. And, you know, it's one of the things that, of course, that this might call to question, right, is that that there's, of course, other migration myths, right, that have to do with indigenous peoples coming to the Michoacán region. And, of course, one of the myths that we know about comes from the Relación de Michoacán, which pertains to the story, the narrative of the Huacusecha Chichimecas, which the Huacusecha was the dynasty, right, that that had power they had governing power, right, in the Tarascan state, as well, the Purépecha state, right?
And just to kind of clarify, I'm diverging. I tend to use Tarascan and Purépecha interchangeably, and again, I know that the Tarasco today, or Tarascan, it's considered an insult, but as a historian, right, I know, like, it's common practice, I guess, like, for historians who are talking about the pre-Hispanic indigenous peoples of Michoacán, that they'll use the word Tarasco Tarascan. But since I'm kind of talking more to a general audience, not just academics, I divert a lot to Purépecha, just because it's the group that most folks are familiar with. And also, you know, to avoid kind of the long strings of angry comments, right, of people saying, like, you know, it's Purépecha, you shouldn't use Tarascan. And I get that, I know that, but again, that's I use that term just, you know, it's I guess it's my practice as a historian, but I can go into that at another time. Okay, so
going back to this article. Okay, so again, so this narrative, right, of folks coming from South America, right, and of course, how do we make sense of this, considering that there's also another narrative, right, that talks about Huacusecha Chichimecas coming, you know, so on the one hand, you have this narrative of Chichimecas coming to Michoacán from the north, but then there's also this narrative, right, of folks coming, traveling through the seas from South America. So how do we make sense of both of this? And, you know, and at the end of the day, you know, they're both migration myths, you know, so we don't really know for sure if they're true or not at the end of the day, right? A legend's a legend, right? But I mean, of course, it is likely that, you know, that both of these legends, right, they might have some truth to it, you know, so it could be the case that, you know what, that the Purépecha themselves, you know, that they were very multi-ethnic, you know, it's likely that they have both Chichimeca and perhaps even, you know, South American origins, you know. And again, keeping in mind that there was already people living in Michoacán before folks came from South America and from Northern Mexico as Chichimecas, right? There was already people living in Michoacán. And I know the anthropologist Helen Perlstein Pollard.
Correction, Helen Perlstein Pollard is an archaeologist and an ethnohistorian.
Talks about a Purépecha culture being in the Michoacán region for at least 2,000 years, right, before the Spanish conquest, right, or before, I believe, I have to double check that source. It's in the book From Tribute to Communal Sovereignty. And she talks about that there's Purépecha origins in Michoacán that go back at least 2,000 years. So that's something we also have to keep in mind, right? Because, you know, again, saying that we also have to be careful and not say that, you know, that Michoacán was kind of this empty land that nobody was living there. And then came people from South America, and then came the Chichimecas, and then, you know, and then populated it. That wasn't the case. There was already people living in Michoacán. So we have to also be careful, right, when we're elaborating, or when we're telling these sorts of narratives, right? the culture in question that goes back for thousands of years also, right? It's the specifically we're talking about here is the Chupicuaro culture that originates in Acámbaro, Guanajuato, goes back from approximately 400 BCE to 300 CE. And so this isn't from his article. This is, I'm going off tangent. I'm bringing out kind of examples of things that I've learned, I guess, over the years. But again, just hammering in the point that there were these kind of pre-existing mother cultures in the Michoacán region. And I would say that the Chupicuaro culture is one of them. Just based on what I've read from Pollard's work. Going back to this point, right, about this myth about traveling, you know, on the backs of turtles. So, I mean, so although it's a myth, right, like I said earlier, these myths sometimes, right, they can come with the, how can I say it? They might have some truth to them. If it's the case that the turtles was a reference to boats, right? We do know that sailing was definitely possible. You know, he cites various examples, right, of Spaniards who knew about indigenous people who knew how to sail, right, up and down the Pacific coast during the early colonial period, right, during the first 100 years after the conquest of Michoacán. So, for example, he cites Pedro de Alvarado, who mentions that he was taken from indigenous navigators from Guatemala to Ecuador. And it's also, you know, he also makes the case that, you know, if they came to Michoacán, you know, these travelers from South America, you know, one of the ways that they navigated there was likely through the Balsas River to get to the coast. And, you know, another example that he cites from one of the Spaniards, it's by Rodrigo de Albornoz. I can never say his name right. Rodrigo de Albornoz. Oh, yes. And the guy's, how can I say it? The guy's a bastard. So if you've read The Conquest of Michoacán by J. Benedict Warren, you know why and what I'm talking about. yeah, and so the guy was a greedy bastard. Anyways, he wrote in 1525, he was Hernán Cortés' accountant, by the way. So here's this quote that he includes from him in 1525. It says, quote, "According to the Indians of Zacatula, at the mouth of the Rio Balsas, their fathers and grandfathers had told them from time to time that Indians had come to that coast from certain islands on the south in large dugout canoes, bringing excellent things to trade and taking other things from the land. Sometimes when the sea was running high, those who stayed for 5 or 6 months what happened here? Oh, I misread that. It says, those who stayed for 5 or 6 months until good weather returned, there were those who stayed. Okay, so never mind. Sorry, I think I wrote that wrong in my notes. But basically, he was saying that there was people of these travelers who would there, right? That would, these merchants that would come from South America, when the weather was bad, they would stay there for 5 or 6 months, right? Until the water chilled out, and then they could go back, right, to South America. Okay, so continuing with this quote, he says, then the seas became calm, and then they could go back. Okay, so again, so this is a quote where the Spaniards are talking about that they were witness, or that they were aware of these traders, right, that came from South America. And I think one of the clearest examples, right, that he points out on this question of South American origins is the fact that the indigenous people of Michoacán, that they were very familiar with metalwork, right, specifically the production of copper tools. And so the ability to master metallurgy, right, is seen as kind of this direct influence from South America, you know, because considering, right, that even though, for example, that the Purépecha might have claimed, you know, Chichimec origins, right, from the Huacusecha dynasty, the fact of the matter is that, you know, what we don't usually associate, right, with the Chichimeca is the use of metal tools, right? Because the Chichimecas, at least from this region, right, for the most part, were known mostly for the use of bow and arrows, for, you know, using wood for the bow and arrow, right, and also using obsidian, but not ever necessarily using metals. So that's also another point, right, that he makes. Another interesting example, of course, right, is the fact that that the languages were very distinct, right? So, for example, Purépecha, right, it was a very distinct language in that it didn't have any of these kind of, I don't want to say didn't have ethno-linguistic similarities to Nahuatl, because there have been recent studies where they talk about, where some folks have talked about words in Nahuatl that were kind of borrowed and used in the Purépecha language, and also vice versa, right? Going back to this, the point that he was making was that the language was so distinct, right, and that even that the Spaniards noticed that Purépecha was nothing like Nahuatl and other languages that were spoken in Mesoamerica. And so he's talking about some of these linguistic similarities, right, that so like why is it that this, that Purépecha was so unique, and you know, and interestingly, right, that Purépecha had so many similarities to these languages spoken in South America. So he cites, for example, a study in 1991 done by Adams where he compares similarities in Purépecha and Quechua. There's a 1987 study by Greenberg in 1987 talking about Purépecha and Chibcha from Colombia. So he has this really good point that kind of just kind of brings this all together, right? And this quote is that he says, the point remains the same. The closest antecedents of the Purépecha language are found in South America. Now, other similarities, he also points out that they had similar pottery objects, you know, things like teapots, even the ways that the stones were laid out, right, in the yacatas and the temple platforms at Tsin Tsun San, you know, they resemble the techniques that are used in the Andes and Western Bolivia. Even mentions, right, like as far perhaps, you know, this is a technique that we see even in Easter Island in Chile. I kind of found this point interesting too, but I don't know how it levels out. But he says, like, yeah, and this is also something that we see in Hawaii, right, in the island of Kauai. I'm sorry, I'm not saying this right. It's but Kauai. So if there's any Hawaiians watching out there, please feel free to correct me on my pronunciation.
Yeah, I just wasn't sure how to interpret that finding. I mean, I'm not familiar with how, I'm not saying that it's impossible that that sort of interchange, right, happened. I just kind of found it like it's a very far away place, but okay.
And I guess, in the conclusion of this article, right, he admits that, you know, and I'm quoting him, he says that all these answers, right, that they can only be theoretical, end quote. But what we do see, some lessons learned, right, from this article is that, yes, for sure, what we can definitely narrow down is the point is that there's definitely an exchange of ideas that took place between North and South America. And so, like, even though that we can't, that there's no way, that I wouldn't say that that there's no way to prove that it's the case, right, that there's folks who came from South America and settled in Michoacán, I think one of the things that we can take from this, right, the overall point is that there was definitely cultural exchange between these two groups. And I think that's just kind of something that we can use to kind of self-reflect and find out, like, hey, well, the pre-Hispanic past, right, or the indigenous past, right, it's more connected than we thought. Because, you know, usually when we think about groups like the Purépecha, the Otomi, the Matlatzincas, the Nahuas, or the Mexica, you know, and when we think about different groups, right, we often, I think, we have this problem, right, of, like, we compartmentalize everything. Like, we kind of assume that there's no way that they came into contact with each other. And I think to assume that, right, I think it's problematic, right? You know, because I think sometimes we have a tendency, especially today, to categorize everything, and we keep, when we categorize things and we put things into kind of little boxes, right, we kind of shut ourselves out to the idea that, like, you know, that it's possible that there was cultural interchange, right, that, you know, people share ideas all the time. I mean, just look at our, you know, human societies today, right? Like, I mean, we share music, we share clothing styles, we share hairstyles, we share different things, right? So we shouldn't be surprised either, right, that this was going on, because, you know, traveling and exchanging ideas, I think it's a very human thing, it's a very human experience, wanting to learn new techniques, sharing them with other cultures, you know, and of course trade, right? I mean, making money, right? That's one of the oldest human practices, the most ancient human practices, right? I mean, shoot, like one of the, I mean, like the earliest stone, I think it's in the Sumerian culture, right? Like some of the earliest writings, human writings, right? I think, you know, was a transaction. And I think I saw a meme about it. I don't know if, to what extent it's true, but it was a complaint written about some sort of merchant or something in the Sumerian culture. And but again, it was related to trade, right? So again, yeah, I think so I guess my takeaway with it from this from reading this is yes, so it hammers in the point that people from Central West Mexico and South America, definitely there was cultural interchange, and we should appreciate that. And yeah, I don't know what else to say. And this is my first time doing one of these. So yeah, so if you like this article breakdown, dale un like, and see you in the next one.